The title of my message this morning is To See or Not to See? That is the question. Ezekiel 47, chapter 47 and verse 6 says, He asks me, Son of man, do you see this? Son of man, do you see this? Well, let me just give you a little idea what the context was here. I preached a message on out of this passage here some months back. The message is called Heading into Deep Waters. Here the angel of the Lord is leading Ezekiel around in a vision, and he sees the temple, and from the temple, in the sanctuary part of the temple, is flowing a river of water. And it gets deeper and deeper. As you remember, for every 1,000 cubits, it got a little bit deeper. At 1,000, it was at ankle deep. At 1,000, another 1,000, it was at knee deep. At another 1,000, it was waist deep. And then another 1,000, it was so deep that he couldn't even swim in it. And it was carrying him along, and you see what was happening there. It was a momentum that was moving, momentum moving. Pastor Bishop Ron gave us a message on the principle of momentum. And you know, there was another message I preached just a few weeks back on opposition. When there's growing momentum, there's going to be growing opposition. But then we have a great God who is able to see us through the opposition. Is that not right? And God, we said, He was not finished and neither are you. So in chapter 47, we see the river of life beginning to flow from the sanctuary. This is a template. That whole thing right there is a template for the church of God. It's a template for our church in particular. We are to see ourselves as being connected to this river of life that's flowing and growing in depth and in momentum. You see, as that thing flowed, as that river of life flowed, what happened? Trees began to spring up beside, many, many trees, and they were rooted, and their roots went down into that water, and wherever that water flows, you know, it brought life, revival. That's what we see that God is after. He's after reviving people. He's after making dead places come alive again. That river flowed all the way down into dry places in the Arabah, down into the Jordan River Valley, and then on down into the Dead Sea, the lowest spot on the face of the earth. And it was dead. Nothing could live there. But when that water flowed, that river flowed into that, everything became fresh. It revived. It lived again. That's the picture that God is trying to paint in our minds. And how often has Bishop made this statement? The picture that you paint is the picture you'll get. We've got to paint the right picture. We've got to let the Lord paint the right picture in our minds and in our imaginations. The question is, Son of man, do you see this? So, the word see here is from the Hebrew rawah. And literally, well, it has both literal and figurative meanings and applications. The basic denotation is to see with the eyes, obviously. But also the derived meanings are to learn to know, to perceive, to make a mental observation, to behold, to give attention to take heed to discern and consider. Son of man, do you see this? Life springs, do you see this? There were some other messages over the last year and a half. There was a call to come, and it was a call to come to the high places. Moses was called to come to the high places when he hit Sinai so that he could see God, so that he could become very intimate, gnosko, to know him intimately, to know what his character and his nature was so that he could lead these people into freedom and into the promises of God. The call is still there to come to the high places and into the secret places. There was another message I preached called Times Are Serious and Our Days Are Short. How should we then live? Then heading into the deep waters, and you know, heading into the deep waters and those trees growing up beside and the river and on down into the into the Dead Sea that became fresh suddenly, and it was teeming with life and teeming with all kinds of fish. And he said that there were fishermen staged all around that fresh water ready to take in a fresh batch of fish. Many fish. That's a picture for us. What do we see? And you know what? In this last year, several ministries have begun to spring up. Life Springs has sprung up with Celebrate Recovery. Fortis Academy has begun. The Digital Church has begun. And we're expanding our influence out into the community. Pastor Bill brought us a message, a centurion's dream. Cornelius, when he observed the Israelites and the children of Israel and how they were governed by the laws of God, he became infected with that order and that peace that came from the laws of the Lord. It brought order and then it brought peace into their lives. The government of God astounded him, it amazed him, and he was captivated by it, and he was taken by the dream of the government of God versus the government of the Roman rule. What are we affected with this morning? There were many prophecies over our church, many teachings, many messages over the years. God has been at work for years to build in us a vision, a dream, a picture, if you will, preparing us to see what he's got planned for us in the future. But first, we've got to see who God is, see who we are in him, and what can be if we will but believe. One man and one and God is a majority, is it not? There are all kinds of things that can happen. Deliverances, reconciliations, peace in families, restoration. Things that we might have thought impossible, God wants to make possible if we can just see it. What can be if we believe? As God asked Ezekiel, he is asking us, do you see this? Are you getting it? Can you perceive and discern this thing? To see or not to see really is the question for us. Bishop's going to bring a series of messages here in September, painting a picture of our history, helping us to see how we got here, why we are here, and where we're going. Our origin, our purpose, and our destiny. He's often stated this same thing. The picture you paint is the picture you'll get. So the question is, what is the picture being painted in your mind, in your imagination? Last night, before I went to bed, I watched a video of the revival that took place in Brownsville, and the Brownsville revival, and it just whet my appetite anew and afresh for what God is after. I mean, we get so used to the norm, you know, and when this pastor began to share how this thing came about, he said, you know what, I had a great church. My church was an awesome church. We had great music. We had great pastors. We had great people. There was nothing wrong with my church, but he said, I just hungered for more. I longed for more. And he said, I would go into the church at night and in the middle of the night at 4 a.m. sometimes and lock the doors behind me so nobody could see me or hear me. And he said, in my guts, I would cry out, oh God, I want more. There's got to be more, Lord. There's got to be revival, your presence, your coming, your visitation. Something more, Lord. You save to the uttermost. You heal diseases. You deliver from demons. We need your power to come and show us your glory, Lord. And a visitation requires desperation, I believe. Well, what do you see? What are you longing for? Here are examples, not unlike you and me. What can happen with one God, one man plus God, or one people plus God? Abraham. God invited Abraham to view the night sky and all the land from the east to the west, to the north, to the south. Count the stars, Abraham. Count them if you can. Count the grains of sand and dream. Dream of the millions of offspring. Yet he had none. But it was an indication of the visions and dreams in God's heart and what he wanted to get caught into Abraham and Sarah's hearts. But they laughed. They didn't have, how can this be? We're too old. It's too late. But God says, is there anything too hard for me? Abraham, I had Isaac. In a sense, God raised Isaac from the dead and Abraham believed him for it. Now Abraham's beginning to see what things are possible with God. Isaac had Jacob and Jacob had Joseph. Joseph had a dream, the dreamer. He had a couple of dreams that got him in real trouble. He shared them with the wrong people. His dream was that he saw his mom and dad and his brothers all bowing down to him. It was a word from the Lord. It was a premonition of things to come, but he shared them with the wrong people, and they hated him for it, and they ripped his coat of many colors off of him, threw him in a pit. They wanted to kill him. Well, they succeeded in killing his dreams, and he became a slave in Egypt. He could have easily forgotten those dreams when they didn't work out. But he saw something God had put into his heart. Something that God had instilled in there when he was a young kid. And he never let go of it. And it kept him all through those years. It kept him steadfast through it all. Through it all. Through it all. I've learned to trust in Jesus. Learned to trust in God. Amen. Through it all. I've learned to depend upon his word. God was with him, and he prospered, and he granted him favor. Even in prison, even when he was falsely accused, even when he lost a good position, it's like everything was going wrong for Joseph. But he saw something, kept that dream alive, that picture was in his mind. He didn't know what it was there for, but he knew that God had something for him. Amen. And you know what? A couple of things happened. He gained a reputation of being a man in whom was the Spirit of the living God. And not only that, of course, he was reconciled to his brothers. Oh, and he saved the nation of Israel. God is in the business of saving and redeeming and making sure he's got a family, all the way from Abraham to Joseph. And then came Moses. Moses' parents, when he was an infant, saw something special. They had a word from the Lord, did they not? And you know what? It was a hard time there because when Joseph followed the Lord's instructions and he didn't, you know, give up, he saved his whole family and that whole family grew into the nation of Israel, right? And they grew so strong and he brought them down to Egypt and up there in that wonderful delta, Egyptian delta there, the Nile Delta, they prospered, they grew, they became strong, but they became an intimidation to the whole nation of Egypt. And so there arose a Pharaoh that didn't know them, and was intimidated by them, and so he put them under slavery for about 400 years. But then came Moses, and there needed to be a deliverer for this people. And Moses' parents saw that there was something. They perceived, they discerned that there was something special about this child. Even though Pharaoh had commanded the midwives to kill all the boys, you see, there was indeed abortion in those days as well, in a way. But God found a way, and those midwives wouldn't. They found a way around the legal decree. And they saved many of the boys. And that nation grew, and Moses was saved and brought to his mother. And he was nurtured, not only physically nurtured, but you know, until the time that he was weaned as a little child, they poured that word into his life, I believe. Moses, you're a special child. God's got plans for you. He's got a hope and a future for you, and I think he's going to use you. And Moses grew up in Pharaoh's house, and he couldn't get that out of his mind. But you know what? He had this redeemer mentality, and he tried, just did it the wrong way, and he killed a guy. And he became a murderer and a fugitive for the next 40 years. Killed a guy, killed his dreams. But God visits him on the backside of that desert in a burning bush, and he says, Moses, I'm not done with you yet. We need a deliverer to release the people of Israel from captivity and from their slavery. God is not done with us yet, folks. Moses' view of himself, though, you know, when God said, you know what, you're the guy, I'm going to use you, Moses still had this whole mentality, this whole sense of failure, this whole sense of shame at what he had done. He's still on the run. He's hiding. He's got tons of fear down inside of him yet that still needs to be worked out. And he says, whoa, no, not me. Who am I? Even if I did go, they wouldn't believe me. I can't even speak well. I stutter. Please send somebody else. God gets pretty frustrated, wants to kill him. But he says to him, Moses, I am who I am. That's who's sending you. I am who I am is sending you. You tell them, I am is going to go with you. And then he says, throw your staff on the ground. And he throws it on the ground, and it becomes a snake. Moses, put your hand in your coat. Pull it out. It's leprosy. Put it back in. Healed. Do you believe now? Sometimes we just need to see something off from God, and it will transform us in an instant. And so God took him, and he says, now do you believe? Now you go with God, deliver Israel from their slavery. It's time for their revival. It's time for the renewal. Later on, God, after Moses had led them out of Egypt, mighty hand of God. God took him to Mount Sinai, and it was here that he was going to establish those people as his people with a covenant. And he calls Moses up to the mountain, and he's to the top of Mount Sinai. And it's here that he's going to let him see who he really is. To this point, he's seen the might and the power of God. But here he's going to see the goodness and the mercy, the greatness and the majesty, the holiness and the justness of the Lord God Almighty. Years later, he brought him back. He brought him to the top of Mount Nebo so that he could view the promised land. He wasn't going to get to go in, but he got him that far. And he brought him up there, and he says, Moses, take a look. This is where these people are going. This is the plans that I've got for them. There's still a promise ahead of them. I want you to know, Moses, I'm not done with them. I'm going to finish what I started with them. But before those Israelites could go into the promised land, God had to work out some of the old Egyptian mentality out of them. Remember how they would keep saying, well, there's giants over there, and they're just so big, we look like grasshoppers in their sight. What can we do? It was a bad report. It was a bad mentality. It was a poor view of things, a poor view of who God was. Poor view of themselves as God's people. And so it kind of just kept them where they were. But Gideon, after Joshua died, and he had led them over into the promised land, And God had driven out many of the people already. There, Joshua died, and there arose another generation that didn't know the Lord. They hadn't seen his mighty works. They hadn't seen his power. And they did evil in the sight of the Lord. And Gideon, it was his time to deliver the people. Many times. If you've got your Bibles, go ahead and turn back to Judges chapter 6. Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and after 7 years, he gave them into the hands of the Midianites. Because the power of Midian was so oppressive, the Israelites prepared shelters. They went in hiding because the consequences of their forsaking the Lord, their God, brought great oppression to them. And they found themselves having to run and hide. Reminds me of Gideon. He's ending up in a wine press. I'm not sure if he had any dreams left. All he could see was gloom, despair, and agony on me. Whoa! Deep, dark depression, excessive misery. Whoa! If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. Negative, hopeless, fearful, threshing the little bit of wheat that he was able to save in a wine press, hiding. The Lord comes. And he says, "Hey, mighty man of valor, what are you doing there? Mighty man of valor? Who, me? Do you know my family? We're nobodies. I'm the runt of the bunch. Who are you talking to, mighty man of valor?" You know what? The Lord had to perform some real brain surgery on Gideon to help him to see from a different perspective so he could begin to believe again. And to dream again. Hey, Gideon, there's freedom out there. You don't have to be in here hiding. You don't have to be fearful, intimidated. You're a mighty man of valor. And God tells him, "You're the one whom I'm going to bring deliverance to the nation. Believe it." God had his work cut out for him to break through all this trash in his head. The ungodly belief system, the false concepts, misconceptions of God himself and his family, just to be able to see the greatness of God and who he was in relationship to God and what can be when he's in agreement with God. To be able to see as God sees. There's freedom, there's liberty, there is revival out there. So, it's back to the question. What do you see? What do we see? What are the visions and dreams that God has deposited in us? Do you even have any? Maybe you just see life through rose-colored glasses. Maybe you're like going through life, "Well, hey, man, everything's okay. I'm good. Don't bother me with all those problems in the world. I'm okay. Hey, you're okay." Kind of like the old head in the sand syndrome. "Just don't upset my apple cart. Everything's cool. It's cool." Right? Or maybe the opposite is true of you. Maybe everything just seems impossible. Maybe nothing's going right in your world. And you're just so nearsighted, you can't see the forest for the trees. Kind of like old Mr. Magoo. You know, he's couldn't see anything. Everything in front of him was so big, he couldn't see anything in the distance, right? And every glass was half empty, not half full. And every molehill is a mountain. All you see are problems. You can't see the forest for the trees. You're so nearsighted. Maybe you've given those dreams up. Or maybe they're just too small. Or maybe your God, in your mind's eye, is just too small. But my God is the author of the impossible. He's the God of the impossible dream. The impossible dream he gave me. He gave me a song, The Impossible Dream. It became my theme song early on, a few years back. It's called to dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world will be better for this. That one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star. What do you see? The greatest gift that God ever gave me was the ability to believe again, to dream again, to see again from his point of view. It took a little while with the process, you know. Some mentoring and a lot of seeking and waiting on God. But soon I began to see a big, wide perspective back here the way God sees things. And to be able to dream again, to believe again. And that's exactly what God wants to do. He wants us to have a big, wide perspective and put on the big glasses. So that we can see him for who he is, see ourselves for who we are in him, and what can be when we see him properly. Amen? Amen. You know, Joel 2:28 is one of my favorite verses. Yeah, part of it says young men will see visions. Another part says you ladies are going to prophesy. But I like the part where it says that old men are going to dream dreams, right? Yeah, it's a process. It took a little while. And you know what? That process, it was hard on the Lord, and it was hard on me, too, for a little while. It's hard on all of us because it has to do with replacing false concepts, misconceptions, and a distorted view of God and ourselves. It's like God gave me a picture of a big old pumpkin, you know, and how when we go to carve it out and put the face on it, so we can see, it has to have the top cut out and it has to be cleaned out. You know, when you look down inside of a pumpkin, it's real mushy. It's all gooey and mushy down inside. Is your brain full of mush? You know, mine was full of mush, unbelief and fear and distorted views of reality. And God says, I'm going to clean you out, Dave. I'm going to realign the way you think. God, help me to think. I used to get up on my toilet stool where I'd go to seek the Lord every morning, and I used to take this Bible right here. It took a long time to find this Bible. It's called The Quest. I used to take this Bible and I'd put it on my head and I'd say, God, you've got to help me to see clearly and to think properly, Lord. You've got to build your word back into my mind and line the walls of my mind with your words, with the way you see things, Lord. I need you, God. And I would wait upon him day in and day out. And little by little, line upon line, the Lord began precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little. Ah, the laws of the Lord, he began to line my mind with the laws of the Lord and his precepts. And you know what? Order began to come back into my life and peace began to reign in my life. And I began to see properly. Thank you, Lord, for your mighty power. Thank you, Lord, for the process. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Getting a proper view little by little. And the end result is to be able to believe again, to see again, Lord. He healed my brokenness, and he can heal anybody, and he can bring deliverance to anybody. That's what God is after. You know what? Here's another picture. Here's another picture. Mike painted it last week when he gave his testimony. The message was his testimony. It was a picture of the normal Christian life. It was a picture of what God can do with one person totally submitted to his plans and his purposes. And the miracles that abounded on a daily basis in Mike's life, just awesome things, redemptive things. Things that we think are impossible, but God says, no, they're not. Just believe me and obey me and go and touch somebody. Mike's testimony was what can be when someone sees God for who he is, what can be when one submits to and believes God for great and mighty things. One people, one church, the eyes of the Lord are running to and fro throughout the earth to show himself mighty on the behalf of those whose hearts are completely his. There is more to be had. You know, when Mike gave that invitation, my heart was so stirred up within me. My desire was this, not just to be effective in the kingdom. I wanted to make an impact. I wanted to make an impact upon somebody's life. Caden came up and he said same words. We prayed over Caden that God would use Caden mightily. Jeremy came up and Jeremy had the same desire in his heart. We prayed that God would use Jeremy mightily and that his tent stakes would widen and God would increase him and his family and his influence and prosper him in Jesus' name. And his wife is a part of the faculty. And Lord, we just thank you for all the things that you're doing. You want to do the same thing in every one of us. You want to make an impact through us, not just an effect, but an impact. You want that ripple effect to take place in every family and in this church as a whole. The eyes of the Lord are running to and fro to find us, those who will believe him completely, see through his eyes. For years, God has been in the process of renewing our minds and building this vision, this sense of identity. Yeah, testing our characters to make sure that we are trustworthy. What has been tested can be trusted and useful then in his kingdom. Are you embracing this process? Do you see what God is after? Are you connecting with the vision? God told Habakkuk to write down the vision, to make it plain so it could be comprehended, understood, so that we could see it and run with it. Abraham, Joseph, Moses, Gideon's destinies were all bound up with God's people. All God's people. And so are ours. God's purpose to redeem the world through his church. We don't pick a church, people, just on a whim. God plants us to grow us, to build us, to prepare us for usefulness and fruitfulness in his kingdom. I remember when I first came to the Lord, back when I was 19 years old. It was during another revival. It was the Jesus movement back in 1969, 70, 71. Outpouring of God. Just an invasion and a visitation of God in the earth, in our nation. God took me from Minneapolis, planted me in Houston. God can do anything. Anything with a hungry heart. God can do anything. Picked me up, a 19-year-old kid, planted me in Houston. It was all happening right there. Thousands upon thousands, just like in Brownsville. People lined up coming in the middle of the night for the next night's services. And it just went on and on and on. And it was the power and the presence of God that people were attracted to. And I was just like, God, I need you. I want you. And that's when God began to move in my life. I've never seen and experienced the power and the presence and the love of God like that ever before. They gave me a job as the janitor, and they built a little room, an apartment up there next to the baptistry for me. I spent 3 years there. They were down, you know, depositing the incredible things of the Lord into my life back then. But I remember I would go up into the balcony when everybody was gone at night. It's pretty spooky in there at night. And I would turn on the PA system, a big old 33 a third records back then, you know. And I'd put Ralph Carmichael on in his choir, kind of a old hat style of music. But it would come on, and I would walk back and forth across the balcony singing and crying out to the Lord. That song, to be used of God, to sing, to speak, to pray, to be used of God, to show someone the way. I long so much to feel the touch of His consuming fire. To be used of God, that's my desire. Is that your desire this morning? That's what God is wanting to build in you. Consuming fire. You know, when I came back to Life Springs, God said, I didn't bring you back here to embarrass you or humiliate you, but to plant you, to grow you, and to finish what I've started. To help you believe again, to help you to see again, to help you to believe for revival, then what happened to you can happen to you multitudes and multitudes and multitudes if you will just believe. Yeah, it's a process. It takes time to develop the right view of things. You can see that with Abraham, Joseph, Moses, and Gideon. Thank God he's patient, huh? But there comes a time when it's time. Time to change the paradigm. Restructure our view of things from worldly to heavenly and eternal. From selfish and self-centered views to a kingdom view of things. It's time to begin to see through the eyes of the Spirit. Yeah, to get on the big glasses. It's time, even as in Deuteronomy, Moses' last words to the children of Israel. In Deuteronomy 8, he says, I want you to turn around and look back and remember all the way that you have come. Remember where you have come from and where you are today. You know, we are where we are today. Each one of you sitting right here in this pew today. You are here miraculously for most of you. Many things could have happened to us. Many things are still happening. But we are here. And we have come from a long place, a long way. And it's not by chance. And guess what? There is a hope and a future and a plan and a purpose that God is asking us to come to connect with. It's time. It's time, you see. Where is the Holy Spirit taking us now? Turn and see where the Holy Spirit is wanting to take us. There is a world waiting for people such as us. So why not me? Why not now? Why not us right here and now? Huh? The river of life is flowing. It's getting deeper and deeper. The momentum is growing. It's time for us to get into the flow and to go with the flow. Get into that deep end with the Lord. Indeed, what is the picture God is painting in your mind and in your imagination? Will you connect with it? Do you see it? The question is, to see or not to see. That is it. Do you have eyes? Will you have eyes to see? I remember a few years back when Robert Duran was here, the men's retreat, when revival comes, he says, life will not be as we know it any longer. Revivals. I encourage you to go online and pull up Brownsville Revival. And just look, there's documents all over YouTube. It's incredible. It will whet your appetite. It will increase your faith. It will increase your hunger. But revivals are messy. They're inconvenient. They're costly. The question is, are we willing and are we ready to go with the flow? If we begin to see from God's perspective, we will be. But we've got to see from his perspective, his point of view. Up here, we get motivated. Up here, we stay inspired. Up here, we believe. Down here, we're like walking dead men. We get caught up with all the things that are too close to us, all the problems. That's all we see. God wants to change it. It's time. I'm feeling the push of the Spirit to not just see, but to engage. It's time to dive into the deep end and go with the flow. Amen. Brian, you can clap. It's a good word. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. This has been rolling over and over in my spirit all week long.
It's time.
This is a song we sang.
Time for last the dead and gone.
A little more volume, please. Volume.
Time for the broken ones.
It's time.
To live again.
Yes, Lord.
It's time.
It's time.
Time for the dead to rise.
Yes.
It's time for the wings to fly. To live again. I can hear the calling.
Yes, Lord.
I can hear the sound of rain. Over the mountains and over the valleys, I hear the calling.
Hey, we hear it, Lord. We hear you, Lord. Oh, yes, we do.
It's time.
It's time.
It's time for the dead to sing. It's time for the walls to ring. With songs of freedom, it's time. It's time for the numb to feel. It's time for the wounds to heal. With songs of freedom, I can hear the calling.
I can hear it, Lord.
I can hear the sound of rain. With a desperation, it's time. It's time for a sacrifice. It's time that we pay the price for our generation. I can hear the calling. I can hear the sound of rain.
Yes, we do.
Calling, it's time.
Lord, we hear you, Lord.
The dead to rise. It's time for the wings to fly. I hear the calling. It's time. It's time for the children to return home.
Yes, sir.
It's time for the prodigals to
come
back.
Hear our prayer, Lord. Hear our prayers, God.
It's time, Lord.
Yes, it's time, God.
Come on, lift your voice.
It is time, Lord. So timely, Lord. It's time to release our wounded spirits. It's time to release those whom we have had aught against. It's time, Lord, to be reconciled. It's time, Lord, for walls to come down. It's even time, Lord, for change from one thing to another. For release from one place to another place. There's all kinds of timeliness going on here, Lord. There's time for me to start moving and get up and get out of my seat and stop sticking my heels in the sand. It's time for me to get going. It's time for me to be a horse and not a mule. There's all kinds of things, Lord, that it's time for here this morning. It's time. So wherever you are this morning, whatever that thing is, it's time. Let's give it up. Let's release it to the Lord this morning. You know, when he said it's time for the prodigals to come home, if you've been praying for somebody for a long time, maybe you've given up. Oh, it's time to believe again. It's time to pray and to believe and to war again for the souls of that one. It's time for the prodigals to come home. There's all kinds of things that it's time for. What do you see? What is God saying? I'm going to release you if you will just believe. It's time. It's time. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, this morning. We believe you, Lord. We believe you, Lord. We believe. Everything to you, Lord. We offer ourselves up anew and afresh, God. We ask that you would transform us in our very view of things, Lord. Oh, that you would help us to see from your point of view. Help us to see from a heavenly view. Oh, and let loose of so much on the earth, oh God. We believe you, Lord. We offer ourselves up to you, Lord, as a living sacrifice to you, Lord. We offer ourselves in everything, Lord, only as your stewards, God. Use us in a mighty way, ways we have never dreamed of before, Lord. We are willing and we will be obedient to you, O Lord. Here we are, O God. We are hearing that it's time, O Lord. You've stirred our spirits, Lord. So we respond in this moment, Lord. Have your way, O Lord. Your way, your way, your way. Overcome our hesitancies. Overcome our stubbornnesses, Lord. Overcome our fearfulness, Lord. We believe you anew and afresh this morning, God. We'll open our eyes to see where you are leading us, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the picture that you're painting in each one of us. Thank you, Lord, that there are things that you have. Some of those things you deposited in us years and years ago, and we've neglected them and we've forgotten them. They've been buried way down in there. Some of us even gave up hope. I did. But through all kinds of ways, you come to dig down where those things were hidden, and you like reach way down into the depths of those of our spirits where we've lost hope, and you begin to pull them up again and just brush them off, all of that dirt that's been covering them, and you bring them up again and you're bringing them out into the light, and through the washing of the water of the word, you're just kind of washing them off, and you're letting us see that, hey, they're still there. They're still there. And you know what? They're like brand new. And if you just take them now and move into them, hey, God hasn't forgotten. Things that you thought were impossible are now impossible. Come on. Let's go. Let's go. Go. Run with your dreams. It's not impossible anymore. With God, nothing is impossible. Amen, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Do you receive it this morning? Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord, this morning. Amen. 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 Amen, Lord. Hallelujah. Well, it's been a good day in the house of the Lord. We thank you, Lord. It's been a good day. My spirit is revived within me. And when we go back into the world tomorrow, Monday morning, guess what? We don't leave all of this here, because he says he's going with us, right? And those visions and those dreams could very well apply. Don't you remember that picture that Mike painted, that the Holy Spirit painted of Mike's testimony in our mind's eye, is very important. The powerful effect and impact that we can have every single day, wherever we are. Divine appointments. Watch for them. Look for them. Expect them. Miracles can take place if we believe. One more time. One more time. Get them on. Get them on. That's all this is about. Seeing people as God sees people. Seeing our circumstances as God sees them. Get the big glasses on. Right? Amen. Well, now may the Lord bless you. And may the Lord keep you. And may the Lord be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. Gracious unto you. And you're going out and you're coming in, you're rising up, you're sitting down, and whatever you put your hand to. The Lord bless you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Greet one another. I didn't say